In this tutorial, we want to show you how to install and start RapidMiner server. We've unzipped and pasted the installation files here on the desktop. The installer is in the bin folder, and you want to make sure to run it as administrator. Even if you're doing your installation while you're watching this video, we still ask you to check the documentation for any changes and updates to the installation process before proceeding. After reviewing and accepting our end user license agreement, you have the option to choose between a local installation, which we'll do in this video, or a setup for a headless installation. In case you're choosing the headless option, the installation will be configured, so you can simply execute it with all the settings ready on the headless machine. Keep in mind that all settings, such as folder paths and ports, need to be set as if you made them from the machine on which the final installation will be placed. On this next page, you're required to fill in your license. Log into your account, which you'll find under my.rapidminer.com or via the My Account link at the top of our homepage. After the login, you can browse to your license area, and under the tab Server, you'll see your license's key available for copy and pasting. We're now presented with the option to choose an installation directory. You're free to choose your location, but make sure it's accessible to the user that runs the service. So you should avoid any user-specific directories. Now, this is the most important page, so we'll go through it step by step. The first field allows you to specify a host name. The host name will be where RapidMiner Studio can reach the server, and where you can reach the server administration GUI. You can also use an IP address here if preferred. The option Bind to this host name allows you to reduce access to RapidMiner's server if you configure the access through a specific option, such as a specific network device of your server machine. The port for the web interface and also for connections from RapidMiner Studio is by default, 8080. If you're using an Oracle Express database like we do, then this port is occupied, so we need to change it and we'll go for 8888. Be very careful to make sure that neither the port you've chosen here nor the internal port nor the database port on the next page is blocked by the firewalls of the machines involved. Now, before we move on with populating fields, let's briefly look at the server architecture so you're clear on what it is you're configuring during the installation. The big box represents a host or virtual machine on which you install the RapidMiner server. So that machine's name is what goes to the host name field. You connect to the RapidMiner server on this machine from a browser or from your RapidMiner Studio via the specified port. As mentioned, we changed it due to a conflict with the listener of the database. Instead of the default 8080, it is 8888. The next field, server memory in megabyte, is the RAM for our RapidMiner server application, which also executes web services and generates web apps. The minimum amount which you need to provide to this is 2 gigabytes, which will also be partially used by other elements of the server, such as user management, logs, etc. The remaining fields are related to our scalable execution pieces of our server architecture called job agents and job containers, respectively. Job agents can be seen as separate instances or applications on a machine, and they can hold one or more job containers. Each job agent is connected to one job queue within the RapidMiner server. Job containers, as the lowest hierarchical element, are really execution applications and can be somewhat compared to CPUs, but they're not restricted to using single CPUs. The communication between the main server application and the job agents, and consequently the job containers, is routed through the so-called internal port, which is 5672 by default. During the installation, we define how many job containers we want to install on our host machine and how much memory they each get. If we decide to have at least one job container, then the agent which owns that container is automatically set up and assigned to the default queue. In scenarios where your server is only used for collaboration, as shared repository, or as execution engine for web services, you could also choose to set up 0 job containers. In such a case, you want to provide as much RAM as you can to the server memory. Note that the feature Run Process on Server, or setting up a scheduled job from your RapidMiner Studio, invokes an execution through a job container, so using that will require at least 1 job agent connected to your server. Of course, it does not have to be on your host machine. This brings us to this second overview, which shows a schematic view of a larger deployment. Here you can see an example of a total of 4 execution options. One is, as before, the execution engine within the server application. The second is the job container deployed on the host machine, and the 3rd and 4th are job agents with containers, which reside on external machines. 2 of the job agents have 1 job container each, and the 3rd has 2, and each of the three job agents is connected to a separate queue within the main server application. This setup is an example of how you can scale and distribute the job execution while loading jobs through a central instance. Okay, now we can move to the last section on this page, which is about services in Java. The Java home folder is the folder into which you've been installing your Java distribution. Make sure to use the full path as shown and select the JDK or JRE. We recommend that you install and use the Java Development Kit and not the Java Runtime Environment, because the runtime folder will be deleted when you upgrade your JRE, and this will in turn corrupt your RapidMiner server installation. We can decide if we want to create a service or not, and then we need to define the name and ID for the service. Both text fields can be changed to anything you like, but the service ID needs to be unique on your machine. On this next page, we'll fill in the details for our database schema. It does make sense to first select the database system so the default values are updated. The host can be described with name or IP. In our case, we could even use localhost, but that would cause a problem if the job agent were installed on another machine. So we recommend that you use the full name. We kept the default listener port during the database installation, so 1521 is fine. Again, make sure the port is accessible through the firewall, especially in cases where your database resides on a different machine. Schema in Oracle Express is XE and not our tablespace name. Then we fill in the username and password and we're ready to test the connection. Great, the test was successful. It is established using the Oracle driver, which is being shipped with the installer files. If yours is failing, then this may be because you're using a MySQL or other database for which you'll need to provide the driver. If you've already downloaded it, you can select it through the JDBC driver location dialog. If you need to swap your driver over time, you may untick the Use Relative Path box, but your driver name and location cannot be changed subsequently. We recommend using this option only in rare exceptions. On this second last page, you can configure an email server for cases where you want to send out reports or results on a regular basis. Settings are like the email client on your computer or mobile device. In case you're using the Redoop extension to integrate RapidMiner Studio with your Hadoop cluster, then you can enable a Redoop proxy here on this last page. The Redoop proxy lets you tunnel all Redoop connections through a single machine residing on the edge of your secure Hadoop cluster, and so it makes the networking configuration easier. You can also install the Redoop proxy on another machine or just run it manually. Please refer to our docs page for more details on that. At the end of the installation, you can see this dialog, which gives you important details. We've created the service, so as described here, we can start it via the command prompt or through the Windows Services dialog. Just hit the Windows key and type Services into the Start dialog. Locate the RapidMiner service and select Start. Here you can also change it to be started automatically with the host. For access to RapidMiner server, you can use any up-to-date browser, and after you fill in the URL, you may need to wait a bit to give the service time to start up, and then hit F5. Make sure to remember the login details, which are by default admin for the user and change it for the password. We won't change it here in this demo, but make sure to change it swiftly in your installation. You can find out how that's done on our documentation pages. And by clicking Login, we're now finishing this RapidMiner server deployment and our tutorial. Thank you very much for watching.